psychiatrist here in Asia. She will speak about how to build the hope for hemodialysis patients.
Before Professor Rafael starts the presentation, I just want to just tell you, Professor Rafael, always this is a tense hemodialysis course. Every course, Professor Rafael shared with us. So she delivered before depression and depression, depression, breaking bad news, quality of life, a lot of psychiatric and psychological issues. And this year, in this course, the initial presentation was the same like the last course, how to break bad news for the patients. But when I had my health problem, and Professor Rafael sent me an email, I said to her, I am fine, and I think that it's better to change your topic from how to break bad news into how to build a hope. Because building a hope is the only guarantee for better mind, for better life. Professor Rafael.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And I learned hope from you, Dr. Thank you for my dear colleague, Dr. Samir Zaki and Dr. Hussein Shaisha for inviting me. I'm always happy to be here. And as I told you yesterday in the opening, that I used to inspire hope from this place. Okay. I know that you are extremely tired. I tried to finish before the time. It's about building hope among hemodialysis patients. The most important issue that when we are talking about hemodialysis patient, cancer patient, any patient, let us think about him as you are thinking about any of our family member if he is sick. Okay? Because to issue the psychological foundation and psychological needs any of these patients, you have to consider that he is one of your family members or that you are in his place. Okay? This makes it very easy because I know that the terminology we use is too much different from the terminology in medicine and surgery, so it is, looks difficult, but let us think as if you are talking about one of our relatives. This is the hemodialysis patient. Of course, we have a lot of work, which is suffering too much. Of course, from the original kidney disease, which may be of and now he is under hemodialysis, which means a certain regimen that he has to follow to come three times per week to have, of course, some of these side effects. Besides the continuation of the original disease of the kidney. Also, secondly to this situation, he will get psychosocial troubles. Mostly, he has some degree of depression, usually not in need of treatment, but he has a certain degree of depression, maybe an anxiety, maybe an anxiety concomitant like phobia, panic, like this. Maybe he prefers now to be isolated from people because he feels that he is disabled. He feels that he put too much burden on his family, that someone must go with him to the hemodialysis. Others should take care of him at home. So, of course, he will not be happy with this. And he start to be too much sensitive towards this. That now I must be dependent on others. This is actually a painful idea, which leads into too much discomfort and psychological pain. Of course, financial status also may be affected. Not always the government supply for the treatment of the people. So now he has also this financial burden for the treatment and also his operational income now is affected because he is not working in the world. Okay? So he has all this burden among the hemodialysis patient. Besides also that having end stage kidney disease, we let him to think about what's coming further. What will be the complication? What I will face in the near future? Okay? So all of this, of course, affect you. Is still there this room? What do you think? I think you are all nephrologists. That's right? Nephrologists, they are all nephrologists? Okay, so do you think while you are dealing with the hemodialysis patient, do you feel hope for him or feel desperate for you as their treating doctor? Yes, I want to hear from you. No hope. No hope at all.
No hope?
No hope.
Maybe he will go to his work the next day.
He doesn't want to work because I lost 100 pounds. Okay? So, we are better in our perception to any event. This is what we call cognitive concept. Okay? So, back to the hemodialysis patient. The perception of each one is different. Usually, as physician, we use to deal with hundreds, thousands of patients. So we consider them mostly as similar cases. Each one of them considers himself unique. He is unique. And if I am sick with the same illness, that this group of patients which I deal with them, okay, I will consider myself different. Okay? So me as me. If I am I'm a psychiatrist, so I'm dealing with depressed patients. When I get depression, or if my family get depression, I consider him as different. He is not like others. Okay? Because each one considers himself different. And this is the condition of all our patients. All the patients you deal with, everyone considers himself unique. Okay? Unique regarding the physical condition and all the other circumstances which may play a role in this. Okay? And that is why also each one has his own condition. And it depends on a lot of issues. It is not our talk today, within our perspective, but financial status, social support, if he is married or not, has children or not, has responsibilities or not, okay? Has good accessibility to health providers. This is very important. All of this will affect his perception to his illness. Okay? So this is very important to take good in our mind. Each one will deal with this problem in different way. One will say, I can do this, I can overcome this illness. Okay? Another one will say, I have to find what to do to be good or to receive my treatment. Each one will think in a different way. So, if I claim, and I am sure that there is always a place for hope. So, how we can to elect? How can we change the attitude of people who feel desperate, who feel that they are helpless, hopeless, okay? And this affect should their adherence to treatment, their willing to be treated, and I'm sure that the prognosis and the outcome of their condition. Because if the patient is not willing to receive treatment, usually the outcome starts to be worse than if he is willing to take treatment or to be treated, even if the physical condition is not good. There are a lot of chances that lead to the effect of the psychological status or that which convey the psychological status on our body. One of them is very important is the immune system. So, if I am depressed, if I am desperate, if I have ideas about death and not suicide, but I think that if I will die now, it will be much better to me and to the surrounding people, okay? All of this will inhibit the immune system, okay? And this gives always a way to any disease to overcome, okay? So how to produce change? First, let us to think what are the determinants of hope. Maybe I just mentioned, but we have actually two major intermingling and inter-affecting factors. One of them is related to the disease, which is a fact and a reality. Although each one will receive it in different way. Although this disease may be of different stages or of different severity. So I have effect. I have effect also that I have money to be treated or I don't have. This affects, okay? And we have individual factors, which is a lot of factors, like, as I have said, financial, my coping way, which I used to use, also spiritual condition, because it affects our status too much, spirit, religious attitude, something like this, and of course the family support. So, when I am talking that I want to enhance hope, this means that I want to enhance the role of hope as a coping mechanism which I have to use. Okay? And coping may be active or passive. If it is active, coping means that facing a problem directly and determining possible viable solution. So I have a disease. The doctor told me that my kidney is not working anymore, either to be transplanted or to be on dialysis. Transplantation is not available to me. Maybe it is very costly or no donors. So I have to go through hemodialysis. Okay? Active coping means that now I know that I don't have other solution. Okay? Or if I can go through transplantation procedure, so I have to look for it, or to ask the opinion of my doctor to have hemodialysis. Okay? So this is active coping. Passive coping, this means to escape the source of distress without confronting it. So I have the problem, I will deny as if it's not here. Okay? So I will continue in my life. I will not deal with the problem. No, the doctor was too much exaggerating when he said that my kidney is not working. I feel well. I'm not so bad, like he said to me. Okay? This is passive coping through what we call denial. I'm denying the whole situation. How can I improve this condition? How can I be more actively coping with the situation? Of course, I need to be more hopeful so I can cope. There are a lot of interventions that we can resort to. CBT is the cognitive behavioral therapy. I don't know if you have any idea about something called cognitive behavioral therapy. It deals with this cognitive construct, which I just talked about, but the problem must be done by specialists. Okay? So, psychiatrist or psychologist is trained on CBT or cognitive behavioral therapy. There are some sort of self-help groups. This means, and this is actually very fruitful and easy to apply, that to have a group of patients in the same situation with, let us to say, with a facilitator. It is not essential to be a therapist, but facilitator, know about this. And know how to guide this group while talking about their problem, what they face from dialysis, to share their experience during the dialysis session, after going home or with their families. So they are sharing their experiences, but with the presence of a facilitator or therapist to modulate the session and to avoid negative currency among the group. This is what we call self-help. Other source like support groups, positive self-talk, these are all need like technician or therapist or trained one. What can the physician himself do? If these are difficult, so what can I do as a physician to my patient? I don't know if Dr. Hussein remembers this. I have talked before about the motivation interview. But I think that it is the way for any physician to do something with his patient in this concern. Okay? So, what is the meaning of motivation? It is what the physician can do for his patient regarding his psychological condition, whether I want to elicit hope, I want to enhance his coping, okay, to promote his adherence to treatment. So I suggest this motivational interview. Motivational interview means when to guide the clinical interview used to be done with any patient, to guide it to be directed toward a certain group. It is used extensively in many issues, many specialties for different goals. Okay, here I am talking about the hemodialysis patient. We need to let him more hopeful in the future, with the meaning of hope here, that positive expectation and to be actively coping with his disease. So we can define it as collaborative because it is a collaborative. It depends on the collaboration between the physician and the patient. It is not one side. Okay, it's not one side process, it is two sides between the physician and the patient. Okay? So it is collaborative. Person-oriented style, because here I must be oriented with which type of patient is this one. Okay? What is his background, social background, economic background? So I am dealing with each one as a unique. So here I am, it is person-oriented. So, of course, it is a type of communication, because interview is a source of communication. So, collaborative, person-oriented style of communication with particular attention to strengthen the motivation for a change. And this is actually the most difficult issue. Change is difficult for all of us. Mostly, we show different degrees of resistance when we have to change any of our habits, okay? And this is what we want to do with our patient, okay? To invite them for change, okay? To change their attitude, to change the way they are thinking about their illness. So, it is to change the attitude of patient from despair or non-adherence to treatment to hope and adherence to treatment. There are nearly some stages suggested for motivational interview, so it can reach to our goal of producing change. The first of them is engaging, by the means that the doctor must be engaged with the patient in his problem, that they are both collaborating together. And in this interview, I'm focusing on my goal, that I want the patient to overcome his pessimism, to overcome his negative attitude, okay? So this is my focus during the interview, and not let it open to talk about all problems, let the patient ventilate about his family troubles or something like this. No, here the doctor knows that he is focusing about this, so he can guide the conversation or the interview. And of course, he should evoke and not implement. And this is very important, that the role of the physician here, not to give direct advice to the patient, but through open-ended questions, and through listening to the patient and feedback him with his opinion, with like I said, open-ended question, so or by statement, so he can involve the patient or promote the patient to give another idea rather than what he believes in. So if the patient believes that hemodialysis will kill me after few sessions, or will enhance the disease. Sometimes a patient like think like this, that if I use to be dependent on hemodialysis, this means that my kidney will never work again. Also, it is already not working. Okay, but mostly people want to put some sort of explanation, okay? No, my kidney not too bad. I think that this kind of treatment will worsen the situation and it will stop to work. Okay? So, if the patient has this idea, I have to correct it, but not with direct advice. Because, direct advice, except if the patient asks me about this, is this true, doctor? So I can answer him. But if I feel that this is his attitude, and maybe he will not clarify it to me, that this what is underlying his negative attitude, or his depression, his hopelessness. So here I have to evoke hope, or evoke the positive attitude, and to let him come through the patient himself. This is, of course, will happen through our conversation. And when I reach this situation, we can put plans together. Like, okay, let us try. And let us follow up together your lab. You will see the lab, what is going on. If it is coming better, this means that this kind of therapy is helpful and not like you thought before. Okay, so we will put plans. Some tips in the motivational interview. First of all, to resist what we call writing reflex, because the doctor will rush to correct the wrong opinion of the patient. Okay, if it is coming like direct or like criticism of what the patient is saying, okay, if like this, the patient will not respond. Okay, because he thinks that the doctor is saying, he is not saying the truth to me. He wants only to assure me. Okay? So, I have to resist this writing reflex, which usually the physician shows. But I have to listen from the patient why he reached to this conclusion, why he thinks like this. Okay? And when I listen to his resources or to what he thinks, now I can like supply him or provide him with another option or another opinion. Okay? And discuss with him. Can you tell me if you see that this opinion looks right, or what do you think? And discuss with him the issue. Let him reach the correct opinion by himself and not through direct advice. We have to understand the patient's motivation, what he needs, to listen to him very well and to empower him. And regarding the hemodialysis patient, I know that their physical condition differs from one patient to another. We don't have to deal with them as if you are dealing with terminal patients. Okay? And we usually say, you are going to dialysis station 3 times per week. You have other 4 days. Okay? So invest the other 4 days to feel that you are a usual human being. And I think that many of them have this power. And I have learned this from one patient who was on hemodialysis. And I was so impressed and so astonished that he is going to his work the other days. Because before, I thought actually that the hemodialysis patient is totally disabled. He can't work anymore. But actually this patient taught me a lot that this, you know, like, it is a camouflage. I think that a patient, so he will not do anything, anytime, okay? And I will not ask him to do anything. But actually, this patient, if his health is compromised and he still can work, or a housewife, lady, that she can do anything, take care of her children while in the other days rather than the dialysis days, this is very helpful to this patient. Because when she feels that she is not too much in sleep, and that she still has a role in life. She still has a role to do with her children, or at work, or anything. This is very helpful to the children, because this helps the caregiver not to be too much stronger. So we have always to empower the patient and encourage him not to surrender totally and come to the caregiver. Okay. This kind of positive self-talk, actually, I can also let us to say suggest it to the patient. That when we feel, because not all the kinds of patient is sitting with me. He will, I will know from his family that while he's at home, he's crying, he's isolated, he doesn't want to mix with others. Okay, so I can tell him to try this positive self-talk. And it is working with all of us in any situation, not only the patient, not only the physical patient. Because this means that when I feel too much negative, or as they used to say, negative energy is overwhelming. Okay? So, I have to remind myself with the positive aspect. Because nothing is all the time negative. Is always positive aspect, even for this patient. If he has someone to take care of him, if he has someone who still like to talk with him or to come to complain from some family problem, this is very positive. That although I am sick, although I am, let us to say, 60 or 70% disabled, still my daughter come and complain to me from a problem with her husband. This is very positive, that she considers me still active. Okay, that I'm still playing a role. So we should clarify this to the patient. Okay, if she is complaining of this, we have to clarify that, no, this is something important. She needs you. And this will, of course, enhance the coping of the patient more and more. So we will advise the patient, search for the positive aspect. Talk positively with yourself when you feel too much low, too much frustrated. We have to advise social support too much. Actually, we have to recommend social support all the time. We have to tell the patient and the family that social support is very helpful in this. And to encourage patients to seek for help, not to be sensitive. To say no, I don't want to be a kind of burden on them. No, it is your right. The patient must know that it is his right. Because sure, before illness, he used to go alone. Even if he's a child. The child actually, sure, before illness, he is a source, was a source of joy for the family. Now he's sick. So his right is to gain family support. Maybe this is what usually happens for children, but for adults or for elders, this is not always there. But actually, it is their right. So we have to clarify to our patient, no need to be sensitive or to feel guilty or shameful that they put a lot of burden on their family, because this is the right of each one of us when he is sick to find his family around him. Spiritual reinforcement. Of course, this depends on the culture, the religious atmosphere for this patient and his family. If the patient belongs to a religious affiliation and they are concerned with it, this is usually very helpful. Feel that I am supported by God and that God doesn't bring bad issues to me. Maybe it has something positive. So usually, spiritual reinforcement is very helpful for some patients who have religious affiliation. So this point, we have to think about it with our patient here in the stage kidney disease or the patient on hemodialysis. So we have to think about this for him. They are. Now, okay. I will finalize these examples. It is to think together. Are you still awake? Okay, for example, a patient will come saying, I don't like the idea of being maintained on this machine. I hear it can have bad side effects. Okay? If your patient come and say this to you, or this during the negotiation about the kind of treatment he has to receive, what I will tell him? Give me suggestions. No
suggestion. Yes, please. Yes. Merci. Pour moi, ça va dépendre d'une chose. Si le patient me le dit entre nous deux, je le change de place. Je lui dis, je lui explique. Qu'en réalité, c'est pas ça, c'est pas vrai, machin, mais je lui change de place. Mais si le patient le dit devant, dans la salle de dialyse, devant les autres, que tout le monde entend, je suis obligé de ne pas le changer de place parce qu'au finish, personne ne voudrait plus jamais aller sur cette machine-là. Parce que accepter le changer de place, c'est dire oui, cette machine cause des problèmes. Et moi, en fonction du lieu et de comment le malade me le dira, je pense que je ferai comme
ça. Professeur Raphaël, do you mean the machine, a specific machine for dialysis in general? Do you mean specified machine or dialysis in general?
I meant dialysis in general.
So if the situation is like this, you will discuss with your patient that you need to do dialysis. Your situation needs support from dialysis.
Yes.
So, and the patient say, I don't like to be connected to any machine and to be supported by this machine, because machine can lead to side effects and can kill me. What
can
you say?
I
yeah.
Okay. I will try to explain it to him. And I will check for facilities. Comment dire, les gens qui peuvent m'aider à lui expliquer. Perhaps his family. Or perhaps I will try to explain it with another person in under dialysis to explain the advantage and the inconvenience of matching. Or making dialysis or not.
So you will do your best first to convince him.
Yes.
And telling him the truth, the benefits, the harm, and the net result is more
yes.
beneficial.
Yes.
And then if you don't succeed, you can repeat it again. And if you don't succeed, you will ask for the help.
From something. Help.
From social supporter. Or from the family.
Yes, or from the hemodialysis patients.
Yeah, I think this is our technique. And,
yes.
And in the opening lecture, if you remember, I mentioned the sharing decision. How to support the patient by giving him this technique for sharing him in the decision. Because if you are eager to convince the patient, the treatment will be more satisfactory. So, we can summarize this into one word, which is facilitation.
Yes.
To facilitate, to put him in the track, to allow him to accept the treatment. Because of the patient, if the patient will be convinced, he will be satisfied at the end.
From my side, I'm always informing my patients that this is a life, this is a replacement therapy, not a conservative treatment. When any organ stops its functions completely, this is a replacement therapy. And I'm always convincing my patients that the renal patients are more lucky than the hepatic or cardiac or respiratory patients. Because if patients with cardiac end-stage renal disease, end-stage cardiac disease, what can you do for him? cardiac transplantation only, but we cannot do anything more for this patient. A patient is suffering from a end-stage liver disease or end-stage lung disease. But end-stage renal disease, our patients is lucky because there are a lot of alternatives for him. Hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis, kidney transplantation, and so on. So, yes, there is some suffering when putting you on the machine, and this is the difference between what God put in our body and what the human being the machines.
And I clarified in my presentation that we should stop saying to the patients, if you don't have this lens, to die. Because it's not the way convincing. I try to convince him, this is the modality to support you. It is replacing or supporting the residual kidney function you have to allow you to eat, to drink, to move around, to feel better. But if I say, if you don't agree to do the dialysis, you will eventually die. This is a bad situation. I need to hear from you, Professor Rafael.
Thank you so much. You elicited already a hope. Yes, this is the spirit of what we are talking about. If you can say, I think it is the same like you have suggested, all that we can say that it is your decision. And this is very important. Let him feel that it is his decision. Okay? I'm not implementing a decision. All I can do is tell you the advantage and disadvantage, and then you can have your decision. Okay? One of my students, undergraduate, asked me what if he finally said, I will not receive the treatment. I will not undergo hemodialysis. And this is his opinion.
We discussed this issue yesterday in the ethical session. So we agreed together with our guests that we should do our best to, because for the consent to be informed, I should explain in understandable manner the consequences of this decision. So if I failed at the beginning, I should continue striving as their guest mentioned that we should depend upon the help of social support from social worker or from the family or from friends. At the end of the day, if I am confronted with a patient who is insisting, I don't agree, this is at the end, this is the patient's right.
Yes.
So long as the patient has mental capacity, this is his right to refuse. Even if the patient comes to us without this mental capacity, but he left advanced directive while he is competent, I don't prefer dialysis. We should respect the patient's preference at the end of the day.
Yes, Dr. Hussain, yes, this is his decision, yes. But we must help him take the proper decision as well. The patient must feel that he is not living alone with his health problem.
Okay, ethically wise, can we ask the help for family member?
Yes.
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 Yes. Yes. Yes, to help us to convince the patient about the utility of the treatment.
And we discussed also one word, which is trust. If we are successful in building trust in the health service, or even not in health service, for the health provider, this will make a big difference. And if we search for a person the patient loves, this may help a lot. Because if he has a message from lover and from trusted people, this will convince him at the end to follow the medical direction. Because when we say patient-centeredness or patient-centered approach, this doesn't mean that we leave the patient to treat themselves. At the end, this is our profession. And if we master the way of communication and way of acting and way of seeking help from the all persons that we are sure that they will affect the patient decision, this is our process. So yes, I agree with Professor Samir that we should do our best. But if you are confronted with a patient that's saying, yes, I respect your opinion, but I will not agree at all for this dialysis. I'll continue at the end for conservative treatment.
Is this another example? If after some sessions, the patient telling me, I don't feel well, and all these sessions didn't help me. So,
yes, please, we want to hear from the female side, one of females. Yes. Yes. No females? What about that? Yes. Yes, please. Yes.
Thank you. I think I will do the same. I have an example that I had a patient, his wife came one of the day of dialysis, and she came crying and saying that my husband today said, I don't want to do dialysis anymore, just going in dialysis to feel what is dialysis. So that was really a difficult situation for me, and I was asking him, where is your husband? And she said, he is at home. He don't even want to come. He said, just for you, because every day he just tell me, just go to the house, go to the house. Today I want you to go and feel what is that. And I said to him, go home, bring your husband, and sit with him, and I mean, explain what dialysis is, and if we think that we need help, call a psychologist that to come and discuss with him, tell him what is that. Those days, the first day he came, just came and wanted to talk with him and say that, oh no, today I don't want to talk with him. I'm just going and sit in the rest. Okay, left him. Went to sit in the rest. The second day, he started smiling. We didn't even talk to him because we were not even afraid to talk with this patient. He started smiling a little bit. He said, oh, today Mr. Carlos is smiling, like he's starting to accept. Who is going to speak to him? He said, let's wait, let's see how the things are going. And the third day, he was the first one coming to us and saying that, I just wanted to apologize, I was feeling bad. And he said, oh, okay, that is the moment to speak to him. So what we did was really to sit with him and explain what that is. But the benefit, they said that, okay, I understand, but I was very depressed and so easy. So I think it's important, yes, to see with the patient, explain me what kind of advantage or disadvantage.
Thank you so much. Because as you see, it is not expensive at all to talk together, okay? It is not costly, just sitting together, talking together, listening to each other, this makes a difference. Okay. This is like some suggestion that I can explain to the patient when he says this to me, that you seem frustrated or you are unhappy with your current patient, with your current doctor, something like this. So I have like to translate what he is saying and what is the meaning of this. That he is angry, okay? He is angry. Because, you know, this is why. Because usually the patient had before better expectation. He didn't know the truth about his illness. Maybe the doctor went so far
in eliciting observation. Okay, so he mentioned some unrealistic outcome figures about the disease. Okay, so the truth actually is usually helpful, but we always say, I am telling something negative. I am giving a negative information by one hand, and I am giving what to do with it by the other hand. So don't tell the patient something about his condition, whether too much better, too much less, okay? But try to be within the range. But if the truth is bad, okay? No, we have to be cautious, because maybe my talk will worsen the situation more. I'm telling him that the prognosis is 90% bad, okay? So he will not be willing to see, okay? We are not doctors, but we are physicians. We are taking care of the patient in this crisis, okay? We have to do our best. And the patient must know this, that we are doing our best. And we have always the capacity to hear from him to modify treatment. If he is not happy with this, we can change, we can see what we can help him through more this way. Okay? So I will remind you again with what I have started with. Think about your patients as if they are one of your close family members, okay? Family members, okay? If you will deal like this, you will be very efficient in your communication with the patient. The other issue, which is very important, that while you have to elicit hope in your patient, please, please, look first if you are hopeful or not. Okay? Because it will be very difficult to elicit hope if you are not hopeful. Okay? And you will not make verdicts. The patient will not regain his full function and the kidney will become 100% well. We know that this is not the truth. But always there is a space to live better than we think. Okay? That we think. We think that is no way, no. There is still a place, okay? So please search for the hope inside you before talking with your patients. This is very important. And thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Rafael, for giving hope to us also.
You gave me hope.
I always say, when you are thinking about your patient must not feel that he is living alone in the world. So when you are speaking about water treatment yesterday, you are speaking about cooperation between doctors, nurses, and the technician. And today, you must provide your patient with teamwork. Teamwork including psychiatrist is very important. Social worker is very important. The social worker must discuss with your patients what about the social life, his family condition, his financial issues, who will cover the finance of his family, because the patient must feel that he is at ease to give hope for him. So we must provide our patients with multidisciplinary team, including the psychiatrist, social worker, and pharmacist, doctors, nurses, and even family members also. You must involve family members in discussing every issue regarding your patient. Now open for discussion for Professor Rafael.
Thank you very much for
discussion.
Thank you very much.
Any question? Yes.
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 Okay.
Merci professeur, c'est complet, j'ai pas de questions, mais juste une situation que j'ai vécue. Une dame de la cinquantaine, que j'ai diagnostiqué une insuffisance rénale terminale due à une hypertension artérielle. Je lui ai indiqué la dialyse. Elle était en hospitalisation, mais elle a juré sur le Coran qu'elle ne veut pas la dialyse. Jusqu'à ce qu'elle est entrée dans le coma. Elle a dit à ses enfants, si je suis conscient et que le médecin vient m'emmener en dialyse, je refuse, si vous m'emmenez, je ne pardonnerai pas. Voilà la situation qu'on a. Comment faire de moi une situation pareille? Est-ce que quand elle est dans le coma, on va très avancer, est-ce qu'on peut se permettre d'entrer en dialyse ou on va respecter son choix?
I think you have to tell her about what's going on, what's her opportunity, what are the options to do, what are advantage and disadvantage, okay? And to clarify everything. And if I am in your place, I beg to her to think again about her decision. Maybe she will have a chance to live a bit better than she thinks. And that maybe things will not go too much bad like she thinks. And I will invite her to try. To try, just for some times. And to think with her about her decision. What will be the consequence of this decision? And to avoid totally to guiltify her. She is free to take her decision. And she must not be guilty to have the decision to die. Okay? So we have to avoid guiltification of the patient. Okay? Just clarify everything to her, put options, and invite her for further discussion. Okay, this is your decision now. Let's talk again after 1 week. And again, we share with her again. What did you hear? What did you do? Ah, she passed away. Yeah. Okay, okay.
Any other questions?
I just want to add the point that without hope, life is impossible. And when we think deeply, happiness is not in money, is not in the position, but with the ability of a person to have a hope. So we should always seek the hope. Because without hope, there is no life. Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Rafael. Thank you. Just an announcement. There is a gift for all of you. And the gift is to have this book about the Urgent Referral Center. So everyone has, and everyone has a book and lift it. Okay? And then, please be in the lobby until 7:30 to give you ample time just to have some rest. And the bus will come to collect you to the restaurant at 7:30 exactly.